you. Good morning. Can I welcome everyone to the 27th meeting of the Justice Committee in 2015? Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as the interview is broadcasting, even when they switch to silent? No apologies have been received. Item 1, decision on taking business in private. I'm inviting you to agree to consider item 5, our budget scrutiny, and 6, consideration of our work programme in private. Are you agreed? Item 2, Criminal Justice Scotland Bill. We now move on to day 3 of stage 2 proceedings on this bill. And I welcome Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary of Justice, to the meeting. I also welcome Scottish Government officials who are here to support the Cabinet Secretary, but as you're aware, we are not able to take part in the proceedings. Members should have copies of their bill, the marshal list, and groupings of amendment for today's consideration. I aim to get as far as we can up until around 11:40. As we have other items of business to consider today, we'll not get through all the amendments, as you're aware, but we can get on with them next week. I know you're looking forward to continuing stage 2. Now I'm going to move on, and the first thing I'll do is I'll call amendment 223 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with other amendments as shown on the groupings. Cabinet Secretary, please, to move amendment 223 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Good morning, Convener. First of all, I'd like to thank you and the committee for altering the normal order of consideration of this bill. As you know, the advisory group were not due to report to me on this matter until the 31st of August, so your scheduling has been extremely helpful in allowing us to debate this issue in light of the advisory group's recommendations. I've already given a commitment to implement the advisory group's recommendations, and it's important to look at this group of amendments in that context. My aim is to use these amendments to make the legislative change that we need in order to implement the advisory group's recommendations in full. I asked the advisory group to consider whether consensual stop and search should end and whether any additional steps would be required to be taken, including any consequential amendment or consequential legislation or changes in practice. I also asked the group to develop a draft code of practice to underpin the use of stop and search in Scotland. The advisory group included a broad membership. This included Police Scotland, the Scottish Police Authority, the Crown Office, academics, representatives from Scotland's Commissioner for Children and Young People, and Anne Houston, Chair of the Scottish Child Protection Chairs Forum and former Chief Executive of Children First. I asked the advisory group to report back in a tight timescale to match the progress of this bill, and I'm grateful to the group, and in particular John Scott, who led it, for delivering the report to last month's deadline. I'm sure the committee will agree that this is a comprehensive, balanced and considered report that makes clear and well-reasoned recommendations. In the summer, I indicated that I would seek an early opportunity to legislate, and that is what we are doing now. I hope that reassures the committee that we are serious about implementing all of the recommendations swiftly and delivering on the new code of practice as soon as can be done practically. I would also like to thank Alison McInnes for her contribution to the stop and search debate over recent months and for lodging amendments 50 to 53. As Alison McInnes knows from our recent discussions, it has not been possible to bend her amendments with the governments. In my view, implementing the recommendations requires a coordinated set of amendments that are more detailed than amendments 50 to 53. We did look at this carefully, but amendments 50 to 53 simply do not lend themselves to being changed in the way that would be required. My conclusion is that the most effective way to ensure proper implementation of the advisory group's recommendations is to draft a new set of coordinated amendments as a single package, which is what we have done. And I'll now move on to the amendments in my name. Amendment 223 to 233 form a set that hang together as one. This would be a whole new part of the bill, divided into two chapters. The amendments insert the new part section by section. Amendment 223 will end consensual stop and search of persons who are not in police custody. The effect of this will be that police officers will only be able to search such a person where they are explicitly permitted to do so by an enactment or a warrant. This is what has become known as statutory search. Amendment 229, 232 and 233 require a code of practice to be implemented after a period of consultation. The consultation is to be both public and with specific stakeholders. This is followed by a requirement for parliamentary approval. The parliamentary approval is under the affirmative procedure, with a copy of the code of practice to be laid to. Amendment 230 provides for the code thereafter to be kept under regular review. The original code will require to be reviewed within 2 years of it coming into effect, and thereafter a review will be required to be held no later than every 4 years. Together, amendments 223, 229, 232 and 233 will implement advisory group recommendations 1 to 4, and they follow the advisory group's recommendations in relation to making, publication and consultation on the code. Amendment 231 will give the code the appropriate legal status. A court or tribunal in civil or criminal proceedings must take the code of practice into account when determining any questions arising in the proceedings to which the code is relevant. Amendment 227 ensures that consensual stop and search will end under Amendment 223 at the point at which the original code of practice comes into effect. Subsection 1 in Amendment 227 achieves this by stating that commencement of the provision in Amendment 223 is to be on the same day as the original code of practice takes effect under the provisions in Amendment 233. This will implement Advisory Group Recommendation 8. Advisory Group Recommendation 6 is that the Scottish Government should hold an early consultation on whether to legislate to create a specific power for police officers to search children under the age of 18 for alcohol. I have already said that we will carry out a consultation on that. The advisory group were not able to form a concluded view on whether such a power was necessary or desirable, which is why they recommended that there should be a consultation. I will make a decision as to whether such a power is necessary after the consultation. However, if after consultation it is decided that such a power is necessary, I would wish to seek the Parliament's consent to introduce that power in a timely manner. Amendment 226, therefore, contains an enabling provision that would facilitate that. It would allow an affirmative SSI to be made to provide a power to stop and search children under 18 for alcohol. That amendment would also allow the SSI to provide a power to search a person who is over 18 where that person is hiding a child's alcohol in order to stop it being found. However, unlike consensual stop and search, such powers will only ever be able to be exercised where the police have reasonable grounds for suspecting that the person has alcohol in their possession. As I said, decisions on whether to make such an SSI will depend on the outcome of the consultation, but ultimately upon that SSI being agreed by the Parliament. This provision is also subject to the sunset clause in subsection 2 in Amendment 227. The result is that if no regulations are made within 2 years of the original code of practice coming into effect, this provision will cease to have effect. Amendment 224 addresses potential but limited gaps in statutory powers that we have identified. There is a possible lack of clarity in current law, and there is a risk that the complete abolition of consensual stop and search under Amendment 223 might mean that the police lack the powers that they need to search persons in certain circumstances. In particular, persons who have not been arrested but who are nevertheless in the hands of safekeeping of the police under some other legal authority. We've identified several circumstances where the police have statutory power to hold and or transport a person from one place to another to safeguard that person's safety and well-being. In order to look after that person and also protect the police officers looking after that person, the police need to be able to search that person before holding and or transporting that person. In particular, there is currently no expressed power of search when the police take a drunk person to a designated place under Section 16 of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995. There is no express power of search when detaining a person under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2013 or Part 6 of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995 or when detaining a child for their own welfare under Section 56 of the Children's Hearing Scotland Act 2011. As I'm sure the committee will understand, the gaps that we have identified cannot be left unfilled. Amendment 224 addresses the gap. It contains a general provision that would allow constables to search a person in the sort of circumstances that I've mentioned. That is, when the person is to be held or transported by the police under specific authority of an enactment, warrant or court order. It should be noted that the power of search is expressly limited not just to specific circumstances but also to specific purposes, namely to ensure that the person in the hand of the police is not in possession of something that could be harmful. This power was not included in the advisory group's recommendations, no doubt because the circumstances that I have outlined were not within the group's remit. However, I believe that these powers are necessary for the narrow purposes of prevention of harm to self and others in limited circumstances in question. This amendment will create a new power of statutory search in those limited circumstances whereby the new power falls within the authority for statutory search referred to in Amendment 223. The committee may wish to know that John Scott is aware that we propose to introduce this new power and he considers that this would be a sensible proposal. Amendment 225 imposes a duty on a constable when deciding whether to search a child to treat the well-being of the child as a primary consideration. This replicates the effect of Section 42 of the Bill in the context of SOP and search. This delivers the intention behind Advisory Group Recommendation 7 and Amendment 53 lodged by Alison MacInnes. Convener, I will now come back to this point later when talking about the non-government amendments in this group. Amendment 228 provides definition of constable and police custody for the purposes of this section of the bill. In summary, Amendment 223 if accepted as a package, will deliver all the legislative changes required to implement the advisory group's recommendations 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7 and 8 in full. For the sake of completeness, the committee will wish to know that the recommendation of advisory group, the implementation of advisory group recommendations 5, 9 and 10 does not require legislative change. Recommendation 5 concerns a transfer of information from Police Scotland to the Scottish Police Authority and the publication of that information. Recommendation 9 concerns the need for a detailed implementation programme, and Recommendation 10 is that there should be discussions about the most appropriate way of dealing with children and vulnerable adults who come to notice during stop and search situations. I now want to turn to the non-government amendments. For the reasons that I've previously outlined, I consider that the intentions behind Amendments 50 and 51 lodged by Alison MacInnes are more effectively delivered by the fuller package of provisions contained in Amendment 223, 229, 230, 232 and 233. And I therefore ask Alison MacInnes not to press Amendments 50 and 51. I also encourage Alison MacInnes not to press Amendment 52. This has been superseded by the advisory group's recommendation 5, which covers the transfer of information from Police Scotland to the Scottish Police Authority and the publication of that information. While I support the principles of publishing information on stop and search, I do not consider that it is appropriate to include this requirement in primary legislation. There are other and more appropriate ways to publish this information as recommended by the advisory group. Amendment 53, lodged by Alison MacInnes, concerned the well-being of the child and mirrored Advisory Group Recommendation 7. My initial instinct was to support Amendment 53. However, on closer inspection, neither Amendment 53 nor Advisory Group Recommendation 7 would quite achieve what they seek to achieve because of their wording and their placing in the bill. Because of its position in section 42 of the bill and the fact that it is not restricted to children who are not in police custody, Amendment 53 goes too far because it targets all searches in all circumstances. This means that it would be unnecessarily and inappropriately affect the police powers of search of people who are being dealt with by the police under the regime for arrest, custody and questioning in Part 1 of the bill. Such people are already protected by Section 42 of the bill. This would also go further than Recommendation 7 of the advisory group, which is explicitly limited to children who are not in police custody. As I said earlier, Amendment 225 imposes a duty on constables when deciding where to search a child to treat the well-being of the child as a primary consideration. This exactly delivers the intention behind the advisory group Recommendation 7 and Amendment 53 lodged by Alison McInnes, and therefore ask Alison McInnes not to press Amendment 53. Amendment 229A, lodged by Alison McInnes, would have the effect of specifying the information that the Code of Practice must contain. As I've said, my intention is to implement the advisory group's recommendations in full. The advisory group looked at this closely and deliberately decided not to be prescriptive about what the code should contain. They provided a draft code and recommended that we carry out a consultation on the draft. That is what I intend to do, and I've asked John Scott and the advisory group to help us develop the code of practice in light of the consultation responses. Parliament will have the opportunity to debate and vote on the code before it is finalised. The process for the code of practice is designed to ensure that the code contains everything that it should. I therefore encourage Alison McInnes not to press Amendment 229A. Amendment 233B, lodged by Alison McInnes, provides that regulations to bring into effect the first code of practice must be laid within 1 year of royal assent. I agree that this is a reasonable time period, and I thank Alison McInnes for lodging the amendment, and I'm content to support Amendment 233B. But we may seek to refine it at stage three if it appears to be necessary on looking at it again when it appears in the bill. So I also undertake to work with Alison McInnes on this matter. Amendment 230A and 233A, lodged by Alison McInnes, are about reviews of the Code of Practice. Amendment 230A seeks to ensure that each review of the Code of Practice is completed within 6 months of the date it begins. I agree with the intention behind ensuring that reviews are carried out as quickly as possible, and I would certainly agree that any review should be carried out within 6 months. I'm therefore content to support Amendment 230A and thank Alison McInnes for lodging it. Again, we may seek to refine it at stage three if it appears to be necessary on looking at it again when it appears in the bill, and of course we'll work with Alison McInnes in considering this matter. The effect of Amendment 233A would be that after each review of the Code of Practice, regulations must be laid for a new code to come into effect, whether the code has been changed or not. I agree with the principle that reviews of the code should be kept under scrutiny. However, I consider Amendment 233A would create an odd result. This is because it requires a revised Code of Practice to be brought into effect even when the earlier version of the code has not actually been revised. In addition, this amendment goes beyond that which was recommended by the advisory group. The advisory group recommends that any revision to the code should be subject to parliamentary approval. And Amendment 230, as read in conjunction with Amendment 233, will ensure that this happens. Any revised code will not take effect until Parliament has had the opportunity to debate and vote on the matter, and I would therefore encourage Alison McInnes not to press Amendment 233A. Amendment 232A, lodged by John Finney, provides that the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner should be added to the list of organisations that should be consulted when preparing the draft code of practice. Pirkwood have been covered by Section H, such others persons as Scottish ministers consider appropriate. However, I have no objection to Pirk being specifically included. I'm therefore content to support Amendment 232A, although I would mention that we may seek to move it to a different place in the list at Stage 3 for purely technical reasons. Convener, I can summarise as follows. Amendment 223 to 233, if accepted as a package, will deliver all the legislative changes required to implement John Scott's advisory group recommendations. I'm content to support amendments 230A, 232A and 233B. And I would encourage Alison McInnes not to press amendments 50, 51, 52, 53, 229A and 233A. I hope that it's clear to the committee that I've taken great care over how to approach this issue, and I've taken into account the suggestions of Alison McInnes, John Finney and other members on these particular amendments. And I'll continue to do so between now and Stage 3 to build as much consensus on this issue as possible. And I move Amendment 223.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for a very comprehensive trip down all those amendments. And I think members actually received some explanatory notes in advance. I think that was helpful because it's quite complex if just was to be put in front of everyone today. Now, I'm going to call Alison just to speak to Amendment 229A and other amendments in the group, to be followed by John Finney to speak to Amendment 232A and the other amendments in the group. Alison first.
Thank you very much, Convener. I want to speak to most of the amendments in this group, so if you bear with me. For 18 months, I was repeatedly told by the Scottish Government that Stop and Search was an operational matter, and ministers insisted they were comfortable with so-called consensual Stop and Search, despite it occurring on an industrial scale and targeting young and vulnerable people, even children. My campaign to abolish so-called consensual Stop and Search and introduce a code of practice won the backing of dozens of charities, academics, the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the Children's Commissioner. And as members will be aware, the government has finally decided to adopt my plans after they were effectively endorsed by the independent advisory group chaired by John Scott QC. I have been pleased to work with the government since that review was published, and I have reflected on the 11 amendments that the Cabinet Secretary has now tabled, which benefit from the additional evidence that has emerged since I lodged mine in February. And I am willing, if John Finney will agree, to either withdraw or not press amendments 50, 51 and 53. However, it's essential that the government's amendments are strengthened in a number of respects to ensure there is no room for ministers to backtrack. So my amendment 229A, as the minister already said, would specify the information that must as a minimum be included in the code of practice. And this is the circumstances in which searches take place, the procedure to be followed, and what records must be taken and the rights of the subject to access it. These provisions aren't onerous by any means and provide ministers with a great deal of flexibility to develop the code, but they will establish what this Parliament expects, and I intend to press that amendment. Amendment 230A specified that reviews of the code should be completed in 6 months, again ensuring that reviews can't just get stalled, and I thank the Government for their support on that. My amendment 233A was to try and reflect my belief that every time the code is reviewed, the Parliament should have an opportunity to reaffirm its support for, or if it chooses, initiate changes, even if the Minister doesn't believe that change is necessary. But I have listened to what the Cabinet Secretary has said in his presentation this morning, and I will not press Amendment 233A. My Amendment 233B was a significant one. It addresses an omission in the government's own amendment, and it requires the introduction of the code of practice and the associated abolition of so-called consensual stop and search to occur within 1 year of royal assent. And with Police Scotland still conducting hundreds of thousands of these unregulated searches, we shouldn't permit the code of practice to slip. I'm very grateful that Minister has agreed to support that amendment. I'm minded to continue to press my Amendment 52, which requires the SPA to provide an account of the use of Stop and Search in its annual report to Parliament, and that would encourage transparency and improved data collection methods. The committee will remember the difficulties around what the figures that were being bandied around. Turning to Amendment 226, Scotland's Commissioner for Children and Young People warn us that this amendment is premature. This is in relation to the powers to develop powers to search for alcohol. Children First indicate that we are concerned about the possibility that such a power could lead to unintended consequences for children, for example, criminalisation and a higher rate of statutory stopping and searching of young people. And I'll note that John Scott's review group reported, and I'll quote, "We have not been able to form a concluded view on whether a gap in power exists that could not be dealt with by existing powers, and also on whether a power to search children for alcohol would be desirable. We therefore recommend that there should be a public consultation that involves children and young people." And the review group went on to conclude, "We therefore recommend this should be considered separately, subject to wider consultation." And I agree that there is no need to have this provision in this bill. In closing, can I say Dr. Kath Murray's groundbreaking research into the prevalence of unregulated stop and search and the effects of these encounters in Scotland shone a bright light on something that needed to be challenged. For a long time, I was a lone voice here in Parliament raising that challenge, but I'm delighted that the evidence has vindicated that approach and that the committee is now on the verge of ensuring that every stop and search conducted by the police has a robust legal basis. We are on the verge of ensuring every search is justified, regulated and accountable. And these changes to the Criminal Justice Bill will be the start of rebuilding community relations amongst those groups disproportionately targeted by this thoroughly discredited tactic. But there's one more hurdle, and I hope members will join me in ensuring that there is no room for delay or for future governments to slide back. And I hope the committee will go back my amendments. Thank you.
Thank you. John, please, to speak to Amendment 232A.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah. Stop and search. Yes, thank you.
Yes.
Stop and search didn't used to be a problem. There was a lot of statutory guidance about it. There was, or the statutes which could, by which stop and search could be invoked. There was a lot of case law about it. It became a problem. I'm certainly very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for setting up the review committee under John Scott. I think it sent a very clear signal that the issues had been responded to. I think we've heard a lot to suggest that that continues to be the case. I won't repeat much of what my colleague Alison has. Sorry, McInnes.
Swearly, you're falling apart already.
I know. Forgive me, please. My colleague Alison McInnes has said, but certainly I'm grateful for the movement that's taken place, and I'm happy to withdraw these. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Members, that's Elaine, then Margaret, then Roderick, please.
Just to say the Labour members also welcome the progress on stop search and the move to putting it onto a statutory basis. But I wanted to invite the Cabinet Secretary's views on 226 and the concern that Tam Bailey, the Scotland's Commissioner for Children and Young People, had about the affirmative procedure, which he thinks is unlikely to allow for sufficient parliamentary scrutiny of a matter that is likely to have wide-reaching effects on children and young people across Scotland. And I wondered whether, and I appreciate that 227 also has a fallback position as well, of if nothing comes forward, that there's a sunset clause in there, but whether the government would be prepared to consider whether or not to make it a super affirmative procedure to allow additional scrutiny by Parliament.
Margaret.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I'm happy to support the amendment in the Cabinet Secretary's name in Stop and Search, which do reflect the review committee recommendations chaired by John Scott. And I'd like also to pay tribute to Alison McInnes. She's been relentless on the scrutiny and in campaigning to address the undoubted abuses of the so-called consensual stop and search. So I think it's a victory for her today too. Turning to the amendment 229A, which I've supported in her name, I note that the Cabinet is not minded to support this because he doesn't want to be too prescriptive, but the amendment just said should include. It's not saying it's a definitive content that should be included, and it seems to me eminently sensible that the circumstances of a search should be looked at and that crucially there should be a record. How else are we to determine how many are taking place if we don't have that record? I'm happy that Alison has withdrawn 233A, and I'm, you know, also as supporter of that motion, happy that it is withdrawn or not moved, intense or not moved. Section 52 seems to me to be sensible and just adds to tightening up the provisions and making sure that they are as effectable as possible by ensuring that a record of the stop and share is included in the CPA annual support, annual report. So I'd be minded to support Amendment 52 also. And again, John Finney's amendment makes sense too.
Roddy, please.
Briefly, Convener, just in relation to Amendment 229A, I've heard what's said about the prescriptive point, but I think the important point for me is that Parliament will have the opportunity to debate and vote on the Code of Practice before it's finalised, so it's not something that won't come back to Parliament. As far as 226 is concerned, I recognise that that's likely to be a controversial area, and as far as I'm concerned, so long as there is a proper opportunity for this Parliament in some shade or form to consider the outcome of that consultation, then I don't have a particular problem with the proposal of the government.
Cabinet Secretary, please, to wind up.
Okay, thank you, Convener, and I'm grateful to the comments made by various committee members. Can I turn first of all to the issue around Amendment 226? And the intention behind this is not to preempt anything, but it's to create the enabling power so that, following the consultation as recommended by the advisory group, that if that power is necessary in order to create the statutory provision for the searching of those under 18 for alcohol, that following that consultation, Parliament will have an opportunity to address that. I do think there is an inherent danger that should you conduct a consultation and find that the recommendation is that we should have something, that there is a gap identified, that we have no legislative vehicle to then pursue that issue if we don't take forward this particular provision. And that is the risk that's associated with the approach that with not taking this particular amendment forward. What I can say as well is that I'm very open to, between now and stage three, exploring where there's a way in which it could be further reinforced. So, for example, Elaine Murray's suggestion of where it should be a super-affirmative procedure, and the committee would be more minded for it to be a super-affirmative procedure. I'm more than content to explore that further between now and stage three, which would give the Parliament additional oversight before any such power could actually be introduced as well. But I do have very serious concerns about conducting the possibility of conducting a consultation recommended by the advisory group, that then if it does identify that there is a legislative gap, that we have no legislative vehicle in which to address that deficit that has been identified within the law. If there is nothing identified during the course of that consultation that would justify having such a statutory provision, then we also have the amendments that create the sunset clause to remove this from the bill in going forward. In relation to the issue around Amendment 229A that Alison McInnes made reference to, the primary purpose for our decision not to accept this was because of the recommendations of the advisory group. The advisory group considered this issue very closely as part of their consideration of this matter and deliberately decided it not to be prescriptive about what the code should contain in itself. And they provided the DAF code with the recommendation that we should then have a consultation on that particular code, and that's what we intend to do. In order to assist with that process, the advisory group are remaining in place, with John Scott heading it up and the other members in supporting the consultation exercise and the drafting of the code, which will eventually be brought before Parliament for consideration. And the key point here is the point that Rod Campbell made, and that is that the Code of Practice has to be laid before Parliament, and Parliament will have the ultimate say on whether its content is correct or not on this particular matter. And the final point is in relation to the Amendment 52 that Alison McInnes made reference to. The reason, again, that we've rejected this particular amendment is because of, again, the findings of the advisory group on this matter and Recommendation 5, where they highlight that Police Scotland, the approach that Police Scotland take just now around data has improved, but also that the process there should be taken forward as a practical measure through on a regular basis with the SPA and Police Scotland to ensure there is adequate openness and transparency, and that will be fully implemented as with all of the other recommendations within the report, and there's therefore no need to put anything on the face of the bill in order to achieve that particular recommendation.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move through the amendments now. The question is amendment 223 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call amendments 224, 225, 226, 227 and 228, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move these amendments en bloc.
Moved.
It's all right. I'm not preempting anything. Bear with me. Does any member... Here we go, Alison. Does any member object to a single question being put on amendments 224 to 228? Yes. So I'll go through them, each amendment individually. I call amendment 224. Cabinet Secretary, move.
Moved.
The question is amendment 224 agreed to?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendment 225. Cabinet Secretary, to move.
Moved.
The question is amendment 225 is agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call amendment 226.
Moved.
Cabinet Secretary to move. The question is amendment 226 agreed to?
No.
It is not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of 226, please show. Those against, please show. 841 against that amendment is agreed to. Call amendment 227 in the name of Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
The question is that amendment 227 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And I call amendment 228 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
The question is that amendment 228 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. I call amendment 229 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with amendment 223. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Call amendment 229A in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, move or not move?
Move.
The question is that amendment 229A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. That's it. 544 against that amendment is agreed to. The question is that amendment 229 as amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Call amendment 213 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with amendment 223. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Call amendment 230A in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is amendment 23A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The question is amendment 230 as amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're agreed. Call amendment 231 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with amendment 223. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is amendment 231 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call amendment 232 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with amendment 223. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Call amendment 232A in the name of John Finney, already debated with amendment 223. John, to move or not move?
Move.
Move.
Moved.
Sorry.
The question is amendment 232A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
The question is amendment 232 as amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Call amendment 233 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with amendment 223. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Call amendment 233A in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call amendment 233B in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is amendment 233B be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
The question is amendment 233 as amended be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call amendment 50 in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Call amendment 51 in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, move or not move?
Not moved.
Call amendment 51A in the name of John Finney. I beg your pardon.
She didn't move it, so you can't move the amendment.
Oh, I beg your pardon. Yes, I'm too fast for myself. Keep me on my toes. Question is... I'm getting there. Call amendment 52 in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with amendment 223. Alison, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No. So there'll be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. 5-4-4 against that. Amendment is agreed. Call Amendment 111 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Group with Amendments 112 and 37. Cabinet Secretary, please to move Amendment 111 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I will deal first with my Amendment 111 and 112, both of which are relatively minor, before turning to Amendment 37 and the proposed definition of arrest. Amendment 111 is simply aimed at improving readability. Amendment 112 clarifies the meaning of offence not punishable by imprisonment. Section 12 of the bill sets down an extra test that has to be met before a constable can arrest someone without a warrant if the offence the person is suspected of committing is not punishable by imprisonment. What this phrase is meant to capture is minor offences for which nobody will ever be sent to prison. But on its own, the phrase could be taken to mean that the particular suspect the constable intends to arrest would not be liable for imprisonment. Children, for example, are never liable for imprisonment, to be imprisoned. Amendment 112 makes clear that in deciding whether Section 12 applies, it is the nature of the offence that is to be considered, not the identity of the particular suspect. Now turn to Amendment 37, lodged by John Pentland. This amendment would add a new section to the bill to provide a definition of arrest for the purposes of Part 1 of the bill. I'm not persuaded that this amendment would do any good, and it could in fact have the opposite effect. Definitions are there to clarify the meaning of the words and expressions when used in the legislation. This proposed definition of arrest would not make the meaning of Part 1 of the bill more certain. The proposed definition is in two parts. The first part refers to depriving a person of liberty of movement. This phrase is open to interpretation and challenge. Would it, for example, cover those who were released on investigative liberation or an undertaking or bail with conditions as to the place where they are, were permitted to go? The second part of the proposed definition is that arrest means taking a person to a police station in accordance with Section 4, which might imply that nobody can be arrested at a police station. This proposed definition of arrest is circular. A person is under arrest within the meaning of the proposed definition if he or she is to be taken to a police station in accordance with Section 4. And who is to be taken to a police station in accordance with Section 4? Well, Section 4 applies in relation to a person who has been arrested. So effectively, this definition states that a person is arrested if the person has been arrested. Part 1 of the bill is, in a sense, an extended definition of arrest. It sets out who can exercise the power of arrest, the grounds for doing so, the rights of the person arrested, and what is to happen following arrest. Picking out one element of that extended definition and saying that is what arrest means for the purposes of the bill does not add anything. There are also many other statutes that use the word arrest without a definition and work well without one. As Police Scotland indicated in their evidence, the bill as drafted would allow them to work in the current legal understanding and definition of arrest, which is well understood by police officers and others in the justice system. While the practitioners understand the legal meaning, I acknowledge that there may be some misunderstanding among the general public of what arrest means. By defining the word in legislation is not going to help that. What I said at the outset, the purpose of defining words and expressions in legislation is to inform the interpretation of the legislation in question. I think there is an onus on everyone who works in the criminal justice system to find ways to make the system more understandable and accessible. And I move Amendment 111 and would urge Elaine Murray not to press Amendment 37 for the reasons outlined.
Thank you very much. I'll call Amendment 37, the name of John Pentland, Lane Murray, to speak to that amendment. Yes, no, I wasn't leaving you alone, yes. Never mind, I can do with help sometimes. You're all doing that. Elaine, please speak.
Just to say a few words regarding the amendment in the name of my colleague John Pentland, and I should actually point out that despite the hilarity about the wording of the amendment, it was actually drafted by the legislation team, not by Mr. Pentland himself. So, you know, if there's criticism there, then possibly it has to be. It has been drafted by people who know what they're doing. However, as the Cabinet Secretary implied in his speech, speaking on this amendment, it was actually the reason that John put this forward was to address that very issue that the meaning of arrest will change in Scotland. And in Scotland, we have a particular view of what arrest means. We think that people are arrested once they have been charged with an offence and not when they have been helping the police with with inquiries and so on. So that John put forward this amendment in an attempt to see if there is a method by which we can clarify that in the public mind, and in particular in the mind of the media, because we were advised during taking evidence on this bill many moons ago, it's probably about 2 years ago, that in England and Wales there have been quite high profile instances where somebody has been arrested for a very serious crime, i.e. they're being questioned, and the media have then treated that person as if they were a suspect, and in fact the person was never charged. And I think it is important that if this bill is passed and the meaning of arrest in Scotland changes, that efforts are made to ensure that people who are what would have been termed helping police with inquiries are not considered to necessarily be having been charged. So I will actually come back to that later, because I have other amendments much later on, probably next week, which look at some of those issues. But that was certainly John's meaning, but I know that John is quite content for that amendment not to be pressed.
Roddy.
Thank you, Convener. I heard what Elaine said. I'm not sure that the reference to helping police with inquiries is actually helping us in our discussions this morning. But I just wanted to remind the committee of what Professor Chalmers said 2 years ago when you said, the distinguished Professor Chalmers from Glasgow University, that the general term arrest has been used successfully for quite some time, despite the fact that nobody can state exactly what the law in that area is. I think the main thing is to remove an artificial distinction between detention and arrest. And if at some later stage somebody wants to attempt to define arrest, then so be it, but not in this bill.
I'm no clearer what's been said there. I think it's made me more confused. Cabinet Secretary, to wind up, please.
Thanks, Convener. Largely for the reasons that I outlined in my earlier comments, particularly around the circular nature of this particular amendment that was proposed by John Pentland, it effectively would not deliver what it's intended to do. I should quickly add that the legislative team that assisted in its drafting was the Parliament's legislative team.
I can see shock and horror on the faces of your colleagues there, Cabinet Secretary.
But no doubt Elaine Murray will wish to consider these matters further before stage three as well. But for the very reasons that I think Rod Campbell has outlined in the previous evidence which the committee received, is that the approach to try and define the word arrest creates a lot of unintended consequences, which I think has the danger of creating further confusion and difficulty interpreting the provisions within the bill, which in part one sets out what is almost an extended definition of arrest in itself.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. The question is, Amendment 111 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 112 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 111. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Question is, Amendment 112 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Now, I think I'll go to the bottom of this, then we'll have a little break, if that's okay. I've got take us down to, I'll call Margaret's next, I think, and then we'll have that. So is that, if you're ready at the starting gate.
Yes, absolutely.
I'll call Amendment 234 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, group with Amendments 235, 236, 237, 240, 241, 256, 257 and 259. Margaret, please, to move Amendment 234 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. It's now been 2 years since the Justice Committee took evidence on the Criminal Justice Bill and Part 1, Arrest and Custody. This is a very important part of the bill, which includes the proposals for changing the current powers the police have for detention, arrest and charge. In addition to this, 2 years ago, the debate and scrutiny of the bill was focused on one particular contentious proposal, namely the provision to abolish corroboration. So there is a very real concern and issue here about the committee, which has in itself changed in composition in the last 2 years. We also have a new cabinet secretary, having the opportunity to properly scrutinise what, by any standards, is a very substantial and significant change in the traditional method by which the police carry out one of their basic functions to protect the public, namely the power to detain, to arrest and to charge. These are terms which are understood at present. The general public know when someone is detained for questioning, they will either be released without charge or arrested and charged. Furthermore, the committee pointed out in its Stage 1 report that there isn't the same stigma attached to someone being detained for questioning and helping police with inquiries as there is to being told someone has been arrested. When we took evidence, the convener stated the public know that detention is different from arrest. They may not know the technical things that lawyers know, but they know that it's different from being arrested. Also, as one of the then Justice Committee members, Sandra White, noted, public perception is that if someone is arrested as opposed to being detained, they are suspected of being guilty of a crime. And Elaine Murray stated, the problem is that although the words may mean the same thing, the public think that when someone has been arrested, the police have sufficient evidence that they may have committed a crime. However, the concerns about this proposed change don't stop there. Crucially, if the proposed changes are agreed, as the Scottish Police Federation pointed out, this is going to result in police officers having to be retrained. This in turn will have the following adverse consequences. It will take up precious police hours at a time when Police Scotland and its loyal and hard-working rank and file officers are already operating under immense pressure. And it will have adverse financial implications within Police Scotland's already strained budget. As the Law Society of Scotland pointed out, the current system is working well, and there's no requirement to move to a system of arrest on the basis that a constable has reasonable grounds for suspecting that the person has committed or is committing an offence. And as Callum Steele of the Scottish Police Federation also said, he was not entirely convinced that the need for change had been demonstrated or that the proposed wording would be more easily understood. These are probing amendments, therefore, which I fully accept have technical flaws. But proposed retention of the status quo in an effort to have a much needed discussion about why the proposals for the new terminology are necessary and can be justified given the implications for Police Scotland both in practical terms and financially. So to allow this discussion to take place, I move Amendment 234 in my name.
Thank you very much. Any other members wishing to speak? John Finney, please.
Thank you, Convener. I listened intently to what Margaret said there, and I would hope to allay her concerns about police training, for instance, because we unanimously agreed a package of issues earlier in our discussions that would have implications for training. And that's part and parcel of how the police respond to the democratic process. Laws are passed here, they pick up on that. I wouldn't be concerned about that at all. I understand the traditional view about arrest and detention, and in my 30 years I saw changes within that. I have to say, for the individual, if you've been wheeched and put away in a police van, it doesn't matter what you call it, it has the same effect. So it's the protections that afforded these individuals that's important to me, and I'm sure that we can get it right and the police service will respond appropriately to whatever we decide in this committee.
I'm looking forward to wheeched being on the official report. Any other members? Yes, I'll take Roddy then, Elaine.
Thank you. Okay, thank you, Convener. Yeah, I kind of accept that it was 2 years ago when we were having a lot of evidence sessions about that, and the committee did seem to formulate, or some members of the committee had a view that in some way detention was different from arrest. But I'm also mindful that Lord Carloway was fairly clear that we needed to kind of do away with that distinction, which was increasingly blurred. And I think that was the view of Professor Chalmers as well. Professor Chalmers was fairly clear that the public knew that there was a difference between detained and being charged. So I'm not sure that Margaret's amendment is really helpful, and I would urge the committee to reject it.
I think she's probing, but we'll get to that bit. Elaine?
I think actually Margaret having put forward these amendments is helpful, even if we don't necessarily agree with the amendments. Margaret referred in her speech about her amendments to the fact that the public don't have a different view of arrest, and that's what I was trying to get at when we were talking about John Pentland's amendment. I think that is an issue. However, I don't have a recollection from 2 years ago, particularly of many people saying we shouldn't be doing this at all, or that this part of the bill should be thrown out. So although I think I agree that we have to be careful about the way in which that the issues around arrest are transmitted to the public and that people become aware of the fact they're different, I don't think that these sections need to be taken out. And I fail to see why it would be such a burden on the police to have just a slight difference in terminology, because they're not going to be doing anything terribly different. It's just it's going to be called something different. So I'm not convinced that this is going to be a huge burden on Police Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Convener Margaret Mitchell's amendments 234 to 241 and amendment 256, 257 and 259 would remove all of Chapter 1 of Part 1 of the Bill, together with the related amendments about arrest. This would have the effect of retaining the current detention arrangements provided for in Section 14 of the Criminal Procedures Scotland Act 1995, together with existing common law and statutory powers of arrest. I believe that would be a backward step when we should be moving forward and modernising our justice system. The Criminal Justice Scotland Bill resulted from an independent review carried out by a respected senior member of Scottish Judiciary, and from the responses to the Scottish Government's consultation on the thoughtful recommendations made by Lord Carloway in his report. This report recommended that Section 14 detention should be abolished, and that the only general power to take a suspect into custody should be the power of arrest. This bill is the legislative vehicle to implement Carloway and to take forward the next stage in reforming the Scottish criminal justice system. It will ensure rights will be protected while ensuring effective access to justice for victims of crime. The bill achieves these policy objectives and reflects the carefully balanced suggestions by Lord Carloway in relation to police pillars. In its Stage 1 report, the committee accepted that there might be benefit in simplifying the powers of arrest along the lines proposed in Part 1 of the Bill, and that is what I think we should be working to achieve. This legislation will modernise and clarify the system of arrest, custody and questioning, and I believe it will keep our communities safe while ensuring that the police continue to act with the consent of the communities they serve. The common law power of arrest for offences will be repealed and replaced with a power of arrest on suspicion of having committed an offence. All other common law powers remain. Statutory powers to arrest suspects for specific offences, which are currently scattered across the statute book, will also be replaced by the single clear power of arrest as set out in Part 1 of the Bill. I also believe that the terminology used in the bill is clear and accurately describes the new regime. The term arrest does not imply guilt. Whether a person is guilty of committing the offence is a matter for our courts. The presumption of innocence remains. The term not officially accused and officially accused have been used to differentiate between two distinct categories of persons. First, people who are suspected of an offence but who have not been charged, not officially accused. And second, those who have been formally charged with an offence which includes accused on petition, indictment or complaint. They are the officially accused. And it's also worth keeping in mind that the Calabi Review concluded that distinction between arrest and detention had been eroded to such an extent that there was little purpose in continuing with the two different states. Lord Calloway recommended that Section 14 detention should be abolished, and the only general power to take a suspect into custody should be the power of arrest. And Chapter 1 of the Bill implements this particular recommendation. And I therefore urge Margaret Mitchell not to press her amendments.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Margaret, to wind up, please.
Thank you, Convener. It seems that the common law just now on the power of arrest is to be abolished, and there is always the possibility when something is put in statute which was previously covered by the common law, with all the flexibility that contains, that there are unintended consequences. And I think we're already seeing some of that when we're looking at, does it include the power for someone to be arrested for their own safety? I don't know if that's been addressed, if it is going to be addressed. Also, the Cabinet Secretary has made much of Lord Carloway's recommendation on the basis that it simplifies the law. It seems to me it does anything but to be arrested and then not arrested, not officially accused, now officially accused. It might make more sense to academics and those steeped in the legal profession. I don't think it necessarily does to the ordinary man in the street. And these powers will affect the ordinary man in the street. There also seems to be a justification for the change in Lord Carloway's recommendation to bring two distinctive means of taking a person into custody under Scots law, to bring it more clearly in tune with ECHR. But in practice, as the Law Society pointed out, the system has changed in the light of CADR, seems to have bedded in well and is working well at present without all these changes. So whilst I appreciate that many of the amendments which will follow today are aimed at improving the new terminology, and on that basis, then I'll look at them on their own merits, I'm not convinced that the new terminology, as opposed to the status quo, is the best way to progress. I won't be pressing my amendment, but I do urge the Scottish Government to look again at this whole section, for there is most certainly a case to be made for taking the proposals for change to detention, arrest and charge out of the Bill to ensure they can be given the necessary scrutiny and to ensure they would, in fact, be an improvement to the current system. Not moved.
Well, you've moved it, so you're seeking to withdraw it. Margaret wishes to withdraw it. Are you agreed? Thank you very much. So I then put the question on Section 1. The question is, does Section 1 be agreed to? Are we agreed?
Yes.
I'm going to suspend for 5 minutes, as I promised. Thank you very much. I now move back on. I call Amendment 113 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendments 114, 238, 239, 10 and 11. Cabinet Secretary, please to move Amendment 113 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Convener, this group of amendments deals with information that suspects will be given after being arrested. I'm sure we all agree that it is this is an important issue because for many people, particularly those who have not previously been in trouble with the police, being placed under arrest may be a distressing and potentially confusing experience for them. I'm aware this committee very much welcomed at stage one the added protections that this legislation will give to people when they are arrested. Amendments 113 and 114 extend information suspects will be entitled to following an arrest. Amendment 113 will give a person arrested by a police officer who is not in uniform a right to see the officer's ID. Amendment 114 amends Section 3 of the Bill to add to the information which that section will require a police officer to give a person who has been arrested. Specifically, it will require the officer to inform the person that they have the right to have a lawyer told that they are in police custody and the right to have a private consultation with a lawyer at any time while in police custody. These rights are laid out by Section 35 and 36 of the Bill. This will ensure suspects are aware of these important rights from the earliest possible time after their arrest. Of course, Section 5 of the Bill already provides that they will be told about them when they arrive at the police station. I appreciate that Alison McInnes's amendment numbered 238 and 239 and John Finney's amendments numbered 10 and 11 are motivated by the same desire to ensure that suspects are fully informed of their rights. However, I'm afraid that I cannot support Alison McInnes's amendments in this group. They would amend Section 5 of the Bill so that the police would be required to tell a suspect on arrival at a police station about the right to have a solicitor present during interview under Section 24 and about the right for vulnerable adults to receive support from an appropriate adult under Section 33. Not all suspects who are detained at a police station are questioned, however, so these rights would not have been engaged. Section 23.2 already requires that suspects who are interviewed are told about their rights to have a lawyer present. Further, Section 5 already ensures that every suspect who is detained in a police station is told about their rights to have intimation sent to a lawyer and to have a private consultation with a lawyer. As I've just explained, Amendment 114 will now mean that suspects are told about those rights even earlier in the process at the point of arrest. Similarly, not all suspects who are detained at a police station have a right to support from an appropriate adult. The rights in Section 5, which the police are required to tell suspects about, are those which generally the suspect has some choice about whether or not to exercise. The right to have support from an appropriate adult is not that sort of right. If the suspect is assessed as needing an appropriate adult support, one will be provided. There is no point having the police tell a suspect that they have a right to support from an appropriate adult if the appropriate adult is already there or en route. And if the suspect has been assessed as not requiring support from an appropriate adult, the suspect will have no right under Section 33 to be told about this. So I'm afraid for these reasons I cannot support Alison McInnes's Amendment 238 and 239. Amendment 10 and 11 in the name of John Finney relate to the letters of rights. Section 5 currently states every suspect is to be given verbally or in writing the information required by Article 3 and 4 of the EU Directive on the right to information in criminal proceedings. Since July 2013, it has been the practice throughout Scotland to provide suspects with that information in the form of a written letter of rights. The letter of rights is available in 34 languages, and from the start of this year, a special easy-to-read version of the letter has been available to help children and suspects with learning difficulties fully understand their rights. The government is committed to continuing to keep this letter under review so that it continues to be fit for purpose. Amendment 10 and 11 would make it a requirement for the information required by the directive to always be given both in writing and verbally to every suspect. I understand that the committee and Lord Bonamy Reference Group have been sympathetic to this requirement. The government is therefore given careful consideration to the practical workability of the proposal. Unfortunately, it has become clear that such a change would have a significant impact on police resource, which the government considered would be disproportionate to the benefit suspects would get from a change in practice. Around 200,000 suspects pass through police stations each year. Police Scotland estimate that the amount of police time that it would take up each year by reading the whole letter of rights to every suspect would be approximately 16,500 hours. And that assumes every suspect has a good grasp of English. Locating an interpreter to read out the letter of rights for those suspects who cannot follow it in English will likely cause considerable delay and will only add to the time the person spends in custody deprived of their liberty. Now, of course, I recognise that even the easy-to-read version of Letter of Rights I mentioned earlier is not going to be suitable for every suspect. Where a suspect has difficulty reading, officers will read the Letter of Rights out. It is precisely to allow flexibility in these circumstances that the Bill says verbally or in writing. As I mentioned in my letter to this committee in August, the police are going to include in their new custody software a prompt to ask suspects whether they would like the letter of rights to be read out to them. I hope members and John Finney himself will agree that a more proportionate way to meet the good intentions behind his amendments is to have the police read the letter to those suspects who need that, instead of having a huge amount of police time expended reading it out to suspects who are perfectly well and able to read it for themselves. Before leaving this subject, convener, I'd like to offer this further reassurance to members of the committee and John Finney in particular. During my statement to Parliament on the report of Lord Bonamy's review group, John Finney endorsed the recommendation of the group that legal aid contributions for legal advice at police stations should be waived. I appreciate that there was previously been concerns that suspects, even when they know about their rights to legal advice, may waive them, as they may be worried about the potential cost implications. This government has previously confirmed it did plan to abolish legal aid contributions in all these circumstances, and I can now confirm to the committee that we will lay regulations to do so before the end of this year. All suspects will be entitled to free legal advice whilst they are detained. This is a significant step that I believe that demonstrates the progress and commitment that is being made to safeguard the rights of suspects and detained persons. I hope this provides further reassurance to members that steps are continuing to be taken to encourage the greater uptake of legal advice at police stations. We will monitor how these changes affect the number of suspects taking legal advice in custody, and as always, I will keep the committee informed of the results. I therefore urge John Finney not to press his amendment, which would pose significant resource problems for Police Scotland and give suspects no additional protection in light of the other steps which have been taken, and I therefore move Amendment 113.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Alison, please, to speak to Amendment 238 and the other amendments of the group, to be followed by John Finney to speak to Amendment 10.
Thank you.
The other amendments. Alison, please.
Thank you, Convener. Well, Section 5 requires that persons in police custody must be informed as soon as reasonably practicable of their key rights, and these currently include the right to have intimation sent to another person, the right of children to access a parent or guardian, and the right to remain silent. My amendments 238 and 239 would extend this list in two respects and ensure those in custody are also informed of their Section 24 and their Section 33 rights, respectively. Section 24 sets out the right to have a solicitor present while being interviewed. In response to a recent parliamentary question, the Scottish Government confirmed that approximately 75% of those in police custody waive their option to consult or have a solicitor present, and I consider that a troubling statistic. The bill rightly ensures people in custody are told of the right to have intimation sent to a solicitor and the right to a consultation at any time. However, unless people are also always told that the solicitor can assist them during the police interview, then they may not choose to exercise their right to a consultation. My amendment 239 would ensure that people are told of the rights listed in section 33, the support available to vulnerable adults. I've listened to what the Cabinet Secretary had to say about that, but the bill currently places the onus squarely on a constable to decide whether someone is unable to understand sufficiently what is happening or to communicate effectively. If we inform everyone who enters police custody of the right to support in these circumstances, we perhaps increase the chance of any individual who does need assistance volunteering this fact, and it would provide a safeguard and increase the likelihood that needs are identified as early as possible. My amendments 238 and 239 are supported by Justice Scotland, which has argued that both these key rights should be on the face of the bill. Turning to the other amendments in the group, I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's Amendment 113 and 114, providing suspects with additional information on their arrest. And I'm sympathetic to John Finney's Amendments 10 and 11 and will listen to his response to the Cabinet Secretary's concerns.
Thank you very much, Alison. John Finney, please, to speak to Amendment 10 and the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Amendments 10 and 11 do relate to the information to be given at a police station and the request that take place both verbally and in writing. Concerns were raised by the Law Society about this, and these indeed highlighted some of the aspects that we already know and frequently come across in this committee, namely the level of literacy that exists among people who find themselves in custody, people often in custody under the influence of alcohol or drugs, and another aspect that we touched on here, the level of brain injury among people who find themselves in custody. So this amendment was intended to ensure that it wasn't simply in 34 languages and a easy read, and I don't know if the easy read's available in 34 languages, but that people were left in no doubt. Because I think the one message we want to give from this committee is that it's legislation that's robust but thoroughly scrutinised. I have to say, I'm bemused that Police Scotland say it's a significant impact in police resources to advise someone of their rights, and that someone has actually costed out the hours, I think, is even misuse of police time, I have to tell you. And the Cabinet Secretary talked about assures every suspect has a grasp of English. Well, of course, we know the background to that is that a lot of people don't have a grasp of English, and communication skills are another factor. And another phrase that gave me no reassurance whatsoever was the question that the term flexibility on rights. There can be no flexibility on rights. And a prompt in police software, well, I want a prompt to be in the police mindset rather than on a piece of IT. That said, I was very reassured by the finish off that the Cabinet Secretary had about the provision of suspects have free legal advice. I think that's very reassuring, and for that reason, I would seek to permission to withdraw these two amendments. Thank you.
Yes, we've not moved them yet. Yes, Alison, certainly, before I take the Cabinet Secretary.
Just before we go to the vote, can I just remind committee members of my register of interest and my membership of Justice Scotland?
Okay. Anyone else wish to come in? Christian?
Yeah, I just wanted to speak about what John Finney said about the misuse of police time. I just wanted to make it clear that for people who maybe English is not their first language, writing a letter will maybe easier to understand that something verbally. And to a certain extent, I can understand Police Scotland when they say that imposing verbally to make the letter available to everybody orally as opposed to in writing might be a misuse of police time for a lot of people who will maybe prefer having it in writing.
I'm just wondering if one of the languages was French. You never know. I think. Gil, please.
Yeah, I can see what John's trying to get to here, but you know, my experience in the motor industry, when people present with a simple thing, having an accident to their car, how excited they really are, and their capacity at that particular time, that's not dealing with the police, that's just dealing with somebody at the other side of a counter. They forget so many things, and I would actually worry I mean, it's commendable that you're looking after people who need help, who maybe are illiterate and can't read and such things, and I would support that idea. But the idea that you would actually use that everywhere, I think it would be much better if, in fact, it was written down and people can absorb it better. They can also, they can look at what's available to them and decide what's important to them. I suspect when it was being read out, they're so excited, so worried about things, it would just pass them by. Whereas if they had the time to look at this and absorb it, then that would be somewhat different. But I do take on board what you're saying. And if there's a way to look at people, obviously if someone can't read and don't understand what the bit of paper is about, then we need to find a way to reach them. So for that reason, I would support you for trying it, to be quite honest.
John, do you want to just say something?
Simply to say, well, the issue is overtaken by events anyway, because best advice is going to be come from the word of mouth of a professional rather than either read out by a police officer or on a bit of paper. So,
Cabinet Secretary, please, to wind up.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened with interest to the points that have been raised by both John Finney and Alison McInnes. And as I've set out the reasons why we can't support Alison McInnes's amendments at this particular stage, I understand the intention she has behind these particular amendments. But the way in which they're presently framed, I don't believe will actually deliver their intent in an effective way, and also in a proportionate way and in an appropriate way. However, I'd be more than happy to explore this issue further with her between now and stage three to see if there is a way in which that can be achieved more effectively than would be achieved through these existing amendments. Turning now to the amendments from John Finney, notwithstanding his decision to withdraw these particular amendments and the level of police time that would be taken in reading out the letter of rights. The letter of rights is a 5-page document. It is not one side, it's 5 pages that officers would have to read in each individual case. And it's not about having flexibility about rights, it's the rights are always there. It's about the flexibility of whether you'd require it verbally or whether you need it in writing. For example, someone like myself, if I was arrested, I would have no difficulty in being able to read this letter for myself. So,
if you were arrested,
so, I suspect more than the record. So, but the point I'm making is it's just to allow officers that flexibility that where they think it's appropriate, that it needs to be read out, that it will be read out for them. But in terms of time, I think once members recognise that it's actually 5 pages, it would take up a significant amount of police resource in having to read that out for every single individual, irrespective as to whether they required it to be read out or not.
Thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 113 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 235 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, already debated with Amendment 234. Margaret, move or not moved?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Don't go to Amendment 114. Yes. Call Amendment 114 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 113. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 114 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 236 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Already debated with Amendment 234. Margaret to move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 115 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Group with Amendment 118. Cabinet Secretary, please, to move Amendment 115 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Amendment 115 amends Section 4 to require the police to release an arrested person before reaching a police station if the person is no longer suspected of an offence. The bill as introduced would, where the arrest takes place out with the police station, require the police to take every arrested person to a police station, even if they were no longer suspected of an offence. The amendment will ensure that people who are no longer suspects need not be held unnecessarily in custody in order to transport them to a police station. Information about all arrests must still be recorded under Section 6. It will not be the case that, therefore, that the power of release will encourage misuse of the system and an arrest first, ask questions later approach by the police. Amendment 118 is consequential on Amendment 115 and requires police to record the information, record the reasons for deciding a person is no longer a suspect and releasing them before arriving at a police station. Recording such decision-making gives further reassurance that arrest and subsequent release can be assessed and scrutinised. I therefore move Amendment 115.
Thank you very much. Any members wish to speak? No. Cabinet Secretary, I take it that you don't want to wind up. The question is that Amendment 115 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 237 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, already debated with Amendment 234. Margaret, move or not moved?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 238 in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with Amendment 113. Move or not move?
As the Minister indicated a willingness to work with me in advance on the intention of it, I'll not move it at the moment.
Call Amendment 239 in the name of Alison McInnes, already debated with Amendment 113. Alison, move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. Call Amendment 10 in the name of John Finney, already debated with Amendment 113. Move or not move?
Not move.
Call Amendment 11 in the name of John Finney, already debated with Amendment 113. Move or not move?
Not move, Camille.
Call Amendment 240 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, already debated with Amendment 234. Move or not move?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 5 is agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 116 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary group with other amendments as shown in the groupings. Cabinet Secretary, please, to move Amendment 116 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
This group consists of miscellaneous minor technical amendments, primarily intended to maintain consistency in the drafting of the bill. Amendment 116 is the most substantive of these minor technical amendments. It amends Section 6.1, which specifies the information which must be recorded when a person is arrested. The amendment makes clear that the recording requirements in Section 6 of the bill only relate to the arrest by the police, not, for example, arrest by a citizen. Amendment 117, 121, 124, 131, 133, 138, 140, 205 and 221 are technical amendments to Sections 6, 8, 11, 36, 50 and 54 of the Bill to ensure consistency in terminology and easier reading of those provisions. Amendment 194 is a technical amendment to Section 39 of the Bill. Section 39 preserves the common law power of the police in relation to people who have been arrested. These include powers to have the person taken take part in identification parades. The amendment replaces the reference to identification parades with a reference to identification procedures. This will make it clear that the police retain common law powers in relation to all identification procedures, including both identification parades and more modern video identification procedures. And I move Amendment 116.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to speak? No. Take it, Cabinet Secretary, you don't wish to wind up. The question is that Amendment 116 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 117 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with 116. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 117 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 118 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with 115. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 118 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 119 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendment 148. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 119 and speak to both amendments in the group, please.
People accused of certain sexual offences, including rape and sexual assault, are prohibited from conducting their own defence. This protects victims and witnesses from the potential trauma of being cross-examined by the accused. This group of amendments restates existing law, which requires that suspects either arrested under a warrant in connection with those offences or charged with these sexual offences are informed that they cannot conduct their own defence and must instead engage the services of a lawyer, failing which the court will do so. The amendment do not change the law, but update the approach and terminology to be consistent with Part 1 of the Bill. Amendment 119 requires the police to record details of their compliance with the requirements set out in Amendment 148. Amendment 148 is the principal amendment. It restates existing law from Section 17A of the Criminal Procedures Scotland Act 1995. The other amendment, 119, is consequential and auxiliary. And I move Amendment 119.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to speak? Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, I take you don't wish to wind up. The question is that Amendment 119 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 120 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Group with Amendments 170, 171, 176, 180, 181 and 188. Cabinet Secretary, please to move 120 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Convener, this group of amendments in conjunction with related amendments in the two groups on rights of under-18s, the first on consent to interview without solicitor, sending of information and access to other persons, other support, and the second on minor amendments. It makes additional provision for the protection of under-18s in police custody. These have specific regard to child protection and wellbeing issues. Amendment 120 requires the police to record the time at which intimation was sent to a local authority to establish whether or not there are likely to be any child protection issues which would prevent intimation that the person was in custody from being sent under Section 30. This amendment is dependent on Amendment 188. Amendment 170 and 171 allow the police to delay the sending of intimation under Section 30 for a child suspect on safeguarding and wellbeing grounds, but only for as long as is necessary to consult the local authority on whether they will arrange for someone to visit the child in custody. In practice, this process is expected to be used where the police have a belief that some form of child protection consideration may exist. Amendment 180 and 181 are technical amendments designed to improve the drafting of the bill. The amendments here are also associated with amendments in Group 21, rights to under-18s at minor amendments. These ensure that where it is not practicable for the police to contact the person that they have been asked to contact, where the person contacted refuses to attend, or where the local authority advises against contacting the person, that the police do not have to contact the person or continue to try to contact the person, as may be the case. In that case, intimation must be sent by the police to an appropriate person, as defined by Section 31(5) of the Bill. When considering intimation and access arrangements as regards persons under 18 years of age held in custody, Amendment 188 ensures that the police take cognizance of compulsory supervision orders set by a children's hearing or a sheriff court. The effect of the amendment is to ensure that where the police believe that a person is subject to such an order, they contact the relevant local authority for advice on how to apply the intimation and access rights set out in Section 30 and 32 of the Bill in compliance with the terms of the order. Furthermore, the obligation to involve the local authority goes wider than compulsory supervision order cases to capture those circumstances where a supervision order may not exist, but the police have concerns about the child's wellbeing. These concerns may be either significant child protection concerns or the existence of other forms of statutory restrictions in respect of the child. For example, a court-issued child protection order or a compulsory supervision order restricting or directing no contact takes place, and where the usual steps of contacting a child's parent or guardian may not be appropriate. In such cases, Amendment 188 requires the police to contact the local authority for advice on who should be sent intimation under Section 30 of the Bill and be permitted to access the person in custody. Amendment 176 provides that where a local authority acting under the provision to inserted by Amendment 188 has advised against sending intimation in accordance with Section 30, then intimation must be sent in accordance to an appropriate person as defined in Section 31(4). And I would ask the committee to support these amendments, and I move Amendment 120.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to speak? No, they don't. Cabinet Secretary, I take you don't want to wind up. The question is that Amendment 120 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. Call Amendment 121 and name the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 116 to move formally. Cabinet Secretary?
Moved.
Question is that Amendment 121 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? call Amendment 122 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with other amendments as shown in the groupings. Cabinet Secretary, to move 122 and speak to the other amendments in the group, please.
Convener, these amendments all relate to keeping a person in custody under Chapter 2 of Part 1, but they address four distinct issues. Most of my amendments in this group and John Pentland's amendments 13 to 17 deal with the proposal to allow extension of the maximum detention period from 12 to 24 hours. I would propose to address these issues first before moving on to John Finney's Amendment 12, which relates to the rank at which decisions on whether to keep a person in custody should be made. I will then speak to Amendment 130, which makes a minor adjustment to the test for whether a person can be kept in custody. I will finish up by covering my Amendment 139 and 141, which deals with the time spent travelling from hospital to the police station. A key purpose of the custody provisions in Chapter 2 of the Bill is to strike an appropriate balance, ensuring no one is held unnecessarily or disproportionately, protecting the rights of suspects and victims while giving flexibility to the police to carry out effective investigation. The bill, as introduced, allows a person to be kept in custody for a maximum of 12 hours. This represents a reduction of 12 hours from the current detention period, which allows extensions to 24 hours. The system is designed to ensure suspects are only detained for as long as is absolutely necessary. The detention limit is not a target, but an absolute maximum. There are strong safeguards built into the system. The initial custody decision must be made by a police officer who has not been involved in the investigation, and a mandatory custody review must be carried out by an inspector after 6 hours. Keeping someone in custody can only be authorised if there are reasonable grounds for suspecting the person has committed an offence and if keeping them in custody is necessary and proportionate, taking into account the nature and seriousness of the offence, the need to enable the offence to be investigated, and the likelihood of interference with witnesses and evidence. Section 41 of the Bill also places a general duty on every constable to take every precaution to ensure a person is not unreasonably or unnecessarily held in custody. There are conflicting views expressed regarding the detention time limits during Stage 1 consideration of the Bill. The Scottish Government made a commitment to consider extending the detention limit to 24 hours in exceptional circumstances. I've now considered the arguments further, and I believe that it is necessary to allow the extension from 12 to 24 hours. I'm satisfied that the Bill contains appropriate safeguards to ensure that this power would be used properly and that such extensions would not become commonplace. It is possible to extend detention periods up to a maximum of 24 hours under the current legislation, but not under this bill as introduced. This means the police would have to release suspects in some serious and complex cases if the 12-hour period expired before the police had obtained sufficient evidence to charge them with an offence. This would not prevent suspects from being arrested and charged later, but releasing them could endanger public safety or interfere with the proper investigation of offences. The current power to extend detention periods to 24 hours is only used for a very small number of cases, less than 0.5%. I believe this demonstrates that the police make appropriate and proportionate use of the power and that it is only used in exceptional cases. The power to extend is necessary in those cases, many of which involve serious and complex offences. Various factors can contribute to creating the exceptional circumstances in which extension to the 12-hour period may be required. The factors which could combine to require an extension to 24 hours tend to affect the timing of when interviews can start rather than the length of the interviews required. The purpose of extension would be to ensure that interviews are conducted in circumstances fair to the suspect and to the victims, and to allow the police to conclude inquiries properly and gather sufficient evidence in order to charge a suspect. Suspects and victims may be too exhausted, traumatised, drunk, under the influence of drugs to be interviewed immediately after an arrest takes place and the suspect is brought to a police station. Urgent work may be needed to interview victims, trace witnesses and conduct other investigations. It may not be in the interest of public safety or the safety of the victim or suspects to release a person suspected of a serious and violent offence on investigative liberation while such investigations take place. In some cases, it is considered best practice to examine a crime scene during daylight hours, even if an initial arrest took place at night. This may apply, for example, to examination of bedclothes at a rape scene. Forensic medical examination may be required before interviews can take place. In areas of rural Scotland, victims and suspects may need to travel to specialist police medical suites or for examination by a police casualty surgeon. These examinations and the travel times involved may reduce the time remaining for conducting interviews if a 12-hour detention limit is applied. Other people, for example, interpreters and appropriate adults, may be required before interviews can commence. It is in the interests of justice and human rights that such people are present at interviews, but it may take time to assess that support is required for an interview, an individual subject, suspect, and then arrange for specialists to attend. Delays are possible if a suspect's needs are not immediately identified because they were also drunk or on drugs. These factors can reduce the time available for conducting interviews, and in complex cases, extending the detention period beyond 12 hours may become necessary in order to conduct an effective investigation. I've therefore lodged amendments 122, 123, 125 to 129, 131, 134 and 135 to 137 to make provision for extending detention limits from 12 to 24 hours. Amendments 13 to 17 lodged by John Pentland would make similar provision. I propose to deal with my amendments first before moving on to considering John Pentland's. Amendment 135 is the primary amendment which allows the detention limit to be extended to 24 hours. This power to extend is limited to serious offences and will be subject to safeguards to ensure it is only used when absolutely necessary. These safeguards include a requirement for authorisation at inspector level and provision for the suspect to make representations. The existing safeguards in the bill also apply, including the statutory test for keeping people in custody, mandatory custody reviews at 6 hours, and the general duty under section 41 not to detain people unreasonably or unnecessarily. These safeguards will ensure that extensions to detention periods can only be authorised in exceptional circumstances and are tempered by the safeguard of regular review, as recommended by the Calloway report. My other amendments are all intended to ensure that the new powers to authorise extension is appropriately woven into the existing provisions about providing and recording information and conducting custody reviews. This includes some reorganisation of sections and adjustments to terminology. Amendment 122 and 123 deal with recording information. Information about the authorisation process and the rationale for extending the time period must be recorded. Where initial authorisation is given to keep a person in custody under Section 7, Amendment 125 will require them to be told that their detention may be extended. Amendment 126 and 127 amend Section 9. And Amendment 126 ensures that a custody review is carried out after the first 6 hours of an extension. Amendment 127 makes drafting adjustments. Amendment 129 amends Section 10 to ensure that the test of necessity and proportionality must be met when deciding whether to keep someone in custody beyond the initial 12-hour period. Amendments 128 and 131 move Section 9 and 10 to after Section 12 of the Bill. Amendment 134 amends Section 11 to require the police to charge or release someone once any extension to 24 hours has expired. Amendment 136 requires the police to give a person certain information when authorisation has been given to extend detention period beyond the 12-hour point. Amendment 137 is a technical amendment to allow time spent travelling to or from hospital or at hospital to be deducted from the extension period. Convener, I'll now turn to amendments 13, 14, 15, 16 and 17 proposed by John Pentland. I wholly support the principle of allowing extensions to the detention period from 12 hours to 24 hours in exceptional circumstances, and I welcome the intention behind the amendments for that reason. But I do not believe that they would offer the same protection to suspects as the amendments that I've outlined above, and I would therefore ask Elaine Murray not to press them. John Pentland's Amendment 15 would permit an extension up to 24 hours where both the current custody test under Section 10 and the additional test of exceptional circumstances were met. Amendment 12 to 14 and 16 and 17 are consequential on Amendment 15. My amendments would offer greater protection to suspects than Amendment 15. In particular, my amendment would ensure an extension could only be granted in relation to serious offences. They would ensure suspects can make representation in relation to a proposed extension. They would require a custody review by an inspector after 6 hours and set out much more detailed requirement for recording and providing information. I do not believe the exceptional circumstances test is necessary. I'm satisfied that the existing power to extend detention periods is only used in exceptional circumstances at present, and that the safeguards set out in the bill will continue to ensure that this is the case. Setting out an exceptional circumstances test would further complicate the statutory test and create a risk of preventing extensions in cases where they were genuinely needed. Amendment 12 in John Finney's name would set out that where a person has been arrested without a warrant and has not been charged with an offence, authorisation to keep the person in custody may be given only by an officer of the rank of sergeant or above. In many of the more rural custody stations, the duty custody officer may be a constable. There has to be a justifiable reason for continued detention, and this has to be authorised by an officer not connected with the case. This provides an independent overview of the initial arrest and continued detention. Custody officers are trained in custody procedures and prisoner welfare. The authorisation to keep a person in custody also starts the 12-hour period for someone who is not officially accused. A duty custody officer is the rank of constable. Of the rank of constable is perfectly able to carry out this function and afford people their rights. The amendment proposes an unnecessary restriction to current practice that would lead to an increase in the requirement for sergeants across Scotland, even if authorisation was given remotely. The amendment would also lead to delays in the start of the 12-hour period while waiting for an officer of a suitable rank to become available. For this reason, I cannot support Amendment 12 and would ask John Finney not to press it. My Amendment 130 is a small clarification to the key test in Section 10 for whether a person can be kept in custody. This test applies to the initial decision to keep someone in custody following arrest. It also applies when inspectors conduct custody reviews after someone has been in custody for 6 hours. The police officer making the decision to keep someone in custody must be satisfied that there are reasonable grounds for suspecting the person has committed an offence and that keeping them in custody is necessary and proportionate for the purposes of bringing them before a court or otherwise dealing with them in accordance with the law. Several factors may be taken into account in deciding what is necessary and proportionate. One of these is whether the person's presence is reasonably required to enable the offence to be investigated. Amendment 130 will clarify that when deciding whether to keep someone in custody, the police may consider whether the person's presence is required to enable the offence to be investigated fully. This has always been the intended effect of Section 10. The amendments make it absolutely clear that police have the ability to undertake a full investigation of an offence while a suspect is held in custody, subject to continued custody being necessary and proportionate for the purposes of bringing the suspect before a court or otherwise dealing with them in accordance with the law. It is also important to note that Section 41 of the bill will still apply to ensure that the police must take every precaution to ensure that the person is not unreasonably or unnecessarily held in police custody. The amendment therefore protects the balance between the public interest in ensuring a thorough and effective investigation and the rights of suspects, as recommended by Lord Calloway and reflected throughout Part 1 of the bill. Turning finally to my Amendment 139 and 141, the bill already provides that the time taken to escort the person to a hospital for medical treatment and any time spent in hospital is not to be deducted from the 12-hour detention period, but it does not take account of the time taken for the return journey. In more remote areas of the country, a return journey from hospital could take a considerable period of time. Amendment 139 therefore provides that the time taken to transport an individual back from hospital will not be deducted from the 12-hour detention period. This will ensure that there is still sufficient time to interview suspects effectively once they arrive at the police station. Amendment 141 protects suspects by ensuring that should a suspect be interviewed whilst travelling from hospital to a police station, then the time spent interviewing will count towards the 12-hour limit. And I therefore move Amendment 122.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We're glad of a rest after that. John Finney, please, to speak to Amendment 12 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I'm always very keen to ensure all our legislation is rural-proofed, as you know. And I'm very much aware that there's a diminishing number of locations where people can be taken into custody in rural areas. This amendment that I propose seeks to change the rank of the police officer authorising someone to be kept in custody from constable to sergeant. Now, many, including the Law Society, welcome Lord Calloway's recommendation that the maximum time a suspect can be held without being charged or advised that he or she is to be reported to the fiscal should now be 12 hours. Elsewhere in legislation, the appropriate constable is someone above a rank of inspector. And I have to say, the idea that authorisation couldn't be given remotely, the idea that there would be there can be independent overview, but it can't be of a supervisor rank. I think it's anomalous to have a constable authorising their peers' decision-making in relation to the deprivation of liberty. And in fact, that's a retrograde step rather than advance. So I most certainly will be pressing this.
Lane, to speak to John Pentland's Amendment 13, please.
John Pentland's Amendments 13, 14, 15, 16 and 17 were intended to address the issue that, in very exceptional circumstances, the police may have to extend the period of custody from 12 up to 24 hours. His amendments specify circumstances, such as when the person is under the influence of drugs or alcohol and unfit to be interviewed, or when access and support for the person cannot be accessed before the end of the 12-hour period, or when it is essential for the person or another person's safety that the person remain in custody. A decision to extend the period in custody could only be taken by a constable of the rank of inspector or above. And as the Cabinet Secretary has indicated, the government's amendments in this area fulfil the same policy intention, but they are more technically competent as they apply to sections of the bill not covered in John's amendments. As we see today, the Cabinet Secretary is supported by an army of government officials, whereas members who are not in the part of the Scottish Government are reliant on the very sterling efforts of the Parliament's legislation team, but they are only two or three people who are having to deal with several bills at the same time, and therefore I am prepared to admit that the Scottish Government's amendments are possibly more technically correct, and I'm happy not to press John's, and we will be supporting the Cabinet Secretary's. On John Finney's amendment number 12, I am very sympathetic to that intention. I, like John, have every interest in ensuring that people kept in custody in rural areas are appropriately dealt with, but like him, I cannot see why a sergeant would not be able to be available remotely rather than having to have a sergeant actually available in the custody area. So I'm inclined to continue to support John's amendment there.
Right, Alison, you...
Please, if I could. I mean, as we know, the Cabinet Secretary's amendments in this group extend the length of time anyone can be kept in custody to 24 hours in some circumstances. The evidence to committee at stage one was mixed on this, and I think we should therefore be extremely cautious in departing from Lord Carloway's view. The Cabinet Secretary set out a reasonable case, but I remain concerned regarding children and vulnerable young people. And without wishing to get ahead of ourselves, I think my support for these amendments would be contingent on whether or not the Scottish Government is going to back my amendment 242 in the following group, which would limit the length of time children and vulnerable adults can be held in custody until for 6 hours. I couldn't in all conscience countenance extending the limit to 24 hours without the addition of safeguards for children and vulnerable adults.
Well, you are ahead of yourself. We will come to that, Margaret, and then Roddy.
Just to speak in support of John Finney's amendment, which I think is sensible, I see no need, reason why it couldn't be done remotely and does give the added protection to people in rural areas as well as in urban settings.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment briefly on the key amendment 135, say that obviously in addition to the provisions under section 41 not to detain people unreasonably or unnecessarily, it does provide that this has got to be authorised by an inspector and it only applies to serious or indictable offences. And there's another small bit which hasn't been mentioned, that the inspector who is authorising this has also got to satisfy himself that the investigation is being conducted diligently and expeditiously. So it's not a laggard's charter. So these should be rare occurrences.
Thank you. Senior Nels, Cabinet Secretary, to wind up, please.
Thank you, Convener. The reasons for which I've outlined not supporting John Finney's amendment stand, notwithstanding the points that I understand Mr Finney has made in regard to this issue. I think it is worth reflecting on the fact that the issue is about the quality of the decision-making that is made in regard to a particular instance in deciding to retain someone in custody. And I'm not always convinced that rank will always lead to better decision-making in these matters. For the very reasons that I would suggest is that there is a significant level of training which is provided to constables, particularly those who have got custodial responsibilities, and been able to...
Cabinet Secretary, continue, then you can come in yourself as well.
There's a growing level of specialism in making many responsibilities role-specific as opposed to rank-specific in itself within policing. Constables, of course, of whatever rank who are fulfilling specialist roles have a greater knowledge and understanding of a specific issue than those who do not deal with these matters on a day-to-day basis, who may be of a higher rank to them. And custody division is now a specialist role due to the intensive training that's given to those officers on prisoner welfare and custody-related procedures, including the various guidance that's issued by the Lord Advocate. So we remain of the view that the decision-making should be held at the position of a constable. And in relation to...
Secretary John, you wanted to say something about that?
Well, I'm not absolutely certain how custody division is configured, but by the very nature of what you've said, Cabinet Secretary, about rural areas, and there are no aspersions being cast by me on the role of constable. I was one for 30 years, and I absolutely, it's the front line and pivotal role. And constables will stand and fall by the decision they take to make deprive someone of their liberty. My suggestion was that it would be enhanced by having independent oversight. And if it is a remote and location, there's not going to be custody division there anyway. And the idea that you would phone somewhere and not get a sergeant anywhere in Scotland seems to me to be, you know, peculiar, to say the least.
Well, I think the key here is not the rank. It's someone with the appropriate knowledge and skills. And in that case, it may be a constable that they would contact remotely for the purposes of getting a custody extended. So I think it's about making sure that they have the necessary knowledge and skills to make that decision. But of course, the committee will come to a decision on whether they think a sergeant or constable is the appropriate rank for making those decisions. And I, of course, welcome the decision by Elaine Murray not to move John Pentland's amendments.
Thank you very much. The question is, Amendment 122 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 123 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Question is, Amendment 123 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. Abstentions? That's 7 in favour, none against and 2 abstentions. That amendment is therefore agreed. Call Amendment 241 in the name of Margaret Mitchell. Already debated with Amendment 234. Move or not moved?
Not moved.
The questions at section 6 be agreed to. Are we agreed? Mm-hmm. I call amendment 12 in the name of John Finney, already debated amendment 1 to 2. Move or not move?
Move, convener.
The questions at amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. 5-4, 4 against, no abstentions. That amendment is agreed. The question is that section 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Call amendment 242 in the name of Alison McInnes and a group on its own. Alison, please, to speak and to move amendment 242.
Thank you very much, convener. As the bill as currently written states that anyone can be held in custody for up to 12 hours. And as I said earlier, members will recall there were very mixed views among witnesses about whether this length of time was appropriate. As we have just discussed, some have advocated the reintroduction of the six-hour limit, while others favoured extending it to 24 in exceptional cases. Sheila McCall of the Scottish Human Rights Commission told the committee that, and I quote, Parliament should think carefully about whether it is ever appropriate to hold a child or a vulnerable adult for more than 6 hours. And the Children's Commissioner, Tam Bailey, also drew attention to the need for stringent safeguards. As it stands, the bill does not include any exceptions or variations. And I think there is a strong argument for reducing the 12-hour limit, or indeed what is, as of a moment ago now, a 24-hour limit, to 6 hours for children and vulnerable adults. This would recognise their unique vulnerability and the additional impact that being held in custody for long periods of time could have upon them. So my amendment 242 would also encourage the police to deal with their cases as priorities and help ensure that they are in custody for the shortest possible period of time. And of course, if further investigations are required, then after the 6 hour period in custody has expired, there would be the option of investigative liberation. And I move my amendment 242.
Thank you very much. Any other members wish to speak? Elaine?
I admit that there were differences of opinion on this, but I don't think I can agree that the limit should be 6 hours, because I think that obviously does include some people with fairly serious offences being under investigation. I think if this amendment redrafted to say that a child or vulnerable adult could not be kept in detention for more than 12 hours, I might actually be inclined to support it, but I think 6 hours is too short a time.
Anyone else, Waddy?
I agree with Elaine's comments on that, but I would hope that the number of children affected is going to be a very small number indeed.
John?
Prior to external events affecting the police service, of course, 6 hours was adequate a number of years ago, more than adequate.
Anyone else? Cabinet Secretary?
Convener, Amendment 242 would prevent children and vulnerable adults, adult suspects, from being kept in custody for more than 6 hours. I strongly believe in the need to protect the rights of children and vulnerable adult suspects within the justice system, but this amendment would undermine one of the fundamental purposes of the bill and prevent serious crime from being properly investigated. It's vital that all offences can be properly investigated in the interests of justice. In doing so, it's also vital to protect the rights of suspects. The fundamental purpose underlying the bill is to balance these sometimes competing interests. This involves providing additional support and protections to ensure that child and vulnerable suspects are not disadvantaged in the justice process. The Callaway Review considered these issues in great detail, and the bill already reflects the delicate balance between these interests that he has proposed. The bill provides strong protection to ensure that no one is held unnecessarily or disproportionately. These include the test of necessity and proportionality under Section 10, the requirement for six-hour custody reviews, and the general duty on all constables to take every precaution to ensure that a person is not unreasonably or unnecessarily held in police custody under Section 41. Where a child is involved, the police will have to treat the well-being of that child as a primary consideration in any decision to keep the child in custody. When a person has been held in custody for 6 hours, Section 9 of the bill requires a custody review to be carried out by an inspector who has not been involved in investigation. The person must be released if it is no longer necessary and proportionate for them to be kept in custody. This is a very important process and ensures that any period spent in custody is tempered by the safeguard of regular review, as recommended by the Callaway report. In relation to vulnerable adult suspects, the bill already strengthens the protection available, placing a duty on the police to seek support to ensure that such individuals understand what is happening and able to communicate effectively, and preventing vulnerable persons from consenting to be interviewed without a solicitor present. As is currently the case, the police will continue to balance interests of justice with the particular circumstances, needs and vulnerabilities of the person being interviewed. The bill also provides additional protection for children. These include duties to treat, the need to safeguard and promote the child's well-being as a primary consideration when making custody decisions. Where custody is necessary and proportionate, the child must be kept in a place of safety rather than a police station. There are also protections incorporated within the bill in respect of intimation to and attendance of parents or other persons at the custody centre. In terms of operational practice, Police Scotland attempt to ensure that children and young people are kept in custody for as short a time as possible. When very minor crimes are committed, it's common for children not to be taken to a custody centre at all, but rather taken home and, if deemed it necessary, cautioned and charged in front of their parents and carers. When children are in custody, the police standard operating procedure states that if they are to be detained in excess of 4 hours, a custody inspector has to review the case. Most people are currently released after 6 hours, but 6 hours is not adequate in all cases. Police Scotland have provided assurances that children and vulnerable adults are only held past 6 hours in a small number of cases, and that they will ensure robust operational guidance and monitoring is in place in relation to this particular power. Before Part 1 of the Bill is brought into force, Police Scotland will undertake a process of updating its standard operating procedure in relation to custody to ensure that these are in line with the new arrest and custody regime. This will include updating existing guidance documents in dealing with children and vulnerable adults in the custody system. Police Scotland will work with stakeholder groups to ensure these guidance documents ensure appropriate protection is provided to children and vulnerable adults in custody. But there will be cases where it is necessary to hold a child or vulnerable adult for more than 6 hours. Children and vulnerable adults may be suspected of very serious or complex offences. The interests of justice demand that such offences should be fully investigated. It would not be in the interests of justice to require certain suspects to be released after 6 hours, regardless of whether the offence has been properly investigated or whether it would otherwise be necessary and proportionate to hold them. I therefore cannot support Amendment 242 and would ask Alison McInnes to consider withdrawing it.
Alison, to wind up, please.
Thank you. Elaine Murray said if I had tabled an amendment with 12 hours, then she might have been able to support it. But of course, when I tabled this, the bill stated that it was 12 hours and we hadn't seen the Minister's amendment. The Minister spoke of the delicate balance that Lord Carloway had to have regard for in relation to the rights of suspects and the responsibilities to investigate crime. But of course, the Minister's Amendment 135 itself affects that delicate balance. And I think that it's all the more important that children's rights and vulnerable adults' rights are protected. And I will press the amendment.
Thank you very much. The question is Amendment 242 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. That is 247 against. That amendment is not agreed. Call Amendment 124 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 124 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Call Amendment 125 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 125 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 125, please show. Those against, please show. Abstentions? 7 in favour, no one against, and 2 abstentions. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 13 in the name of John Pentland. Already debate with Amendment 122. Elaine Murray, move or not move?
Not moved.
The questions at Section 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 126 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debate with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally?
Moved.
The question is Amendment 126 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed there'll be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 126, please show. Those against, please show. So I'm glad somebody else makes mistakes, Alison, and not just me. And though, any abstentions? Those in favour, 7. There were nobody against, and 2 abstentions. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 127 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Questions Amendment 127 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The question is that Section 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 128 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Question is Amendment 128 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Call Amendment 129 in the name of Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Question is Amendment 129 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 129, please show. Those against? Abstentions? That's 7 for, none against, and 2 abstentions. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 130 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 130 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Agreed. Now, at last, Mary Fee, you get it. You've been sitting a long time. I call Amendment 39 in the name of Mary Fee Group with Amendments 110, 41 to 45 and 260. Mary, please, to move Amendment 39 and speak to the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. My amendments in this group are designed to ensure that the issues faced by children and young people affected by their parents' involvement in the justice system are flagged up as part of early intervention and prevention procedures. As the committee will know from the session on the 8th of September, I wish to see more recognition of children and young people affected by their parents' offending behaviour at all stages of the justice process, starting from the point of arrest. And I believe that we need a more joined-up approach to supporting these children, and this approach should include a raft of agencies, including the police. And I hope to receive reassurances from the Cabinet Secretary, if these amendments are not accepted, that the intentions behind them can be addressed in other non-legislative ways. And I do believe that more needs to be done to encourage police to consider the impact of arresting a parent on their dependent children. And there is undoubtedly a role for the named person to play here, and I would welcome the Cabinet Secretary's comments on how he believes we can do this more effectively. Amendment 39 would ensure that the factors to be met as part of the test in Section 10 for keeping a person in custody under Section 7(4) and for reviewing continuation of custody after 6 hours under Section 9(2) would include the impact on the person's dependent child or children. Section 10(2A) provides that one of the factors which the police may consider as part of this test is whether the person's presence is reasonably required to enable the offence to be investigated. This recognises that the police can investigate an offence without necessarily requiring the person to be kept in custody. This amendment would extend this recognition to ensure that the police, in deciding whether or not to keep the person in custody, should also consider the impact of keeping the person in custody on the person's dependent child or children. And this factor must be taken into account in cases where it might not be necessary for the police to keep the person in custody in order to investigate the offence. And this is particularly important where the person is the primary or sole carer for any dependent child or children. Amendment 110 outlines the procedures to be followed by the police where a person with a dependent child or children is taken into police custody. It specifically relates to the provision of information to the named person set out in the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014. And at the moment, the procedures which the police will follow where a person with a dependent child or children is arrested and taken into custody are unclear. And what this amendment seeks to do is to provide clarity in what the police should do in such cases, act as an early warning system. For instance, if an adult with dependent children is arrested for a very serious offence or is a repeat offender, and the police consider this behaviour may have an impact on the well-being of any dependent children, they must share this information with the named person. The Scottish Government's own guidance on the named person states that practitioners should not wait until a situation has reached crisis point before sharing information. They should also share when there are smaller changes. This allows patterns to emerge, and these can often point to more serious concerns, allowing appropriate help to be offered at an early stage.
And this amendment is necessary because whilst a child's own offending behaviour is an obvious and visible wellbeing concern, children affected by their parents' offending will not always be present or visible to police, so there needs to be a trigger. And this amendment would ensure that police are always thinking about any dependent children a suspected offender may have, consistently asking the question and considering at what point the behaviour of the suspected offender may start to have an effect on the well-being of any dependent children. Amendments 41 to 45 are fairly minor amendments which provide clarification, and the amendments would extend the duty in section 42 to ensure that the best interests of any dependent children are taken into account when arresting, holding, interviewing or charging a person with responsibility for a child. In 2012, the UK, with Scottish Government support, accepted a recommendation made in the course of the UK's human rights peer review at the UN Human Rights Council, which asked the UK to ensure that the best interests of the child are taken into account when arresting, detaining, sentencing or considering early release for a sole or primary carer of a child. My amendments are consistent with this recommendation. Section 42 of the Bill seeks to integrate the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child into Scottish criminal justice legislation, and this is to be welcomed. The focus on the best interests of the child and their well-being as paramount is a positive step forward in ensuring that children and young people are treated appropriately within the criminal justice system. However, children and young people can also be indirectly drawn into the criminal justice system through the offending behaviour of their parents or primary caregivers. And my amendments would require a constable to consider the best interest of any dependent children an offender has from point of arrest through to being charged. And this will help ensure that the needs of these often forgotten children are met and their well-being is considered a priority during the often trying period of their caregivers' time within the criminal justice system. The more opportunities there are, the more likely a suspect is to disclose this information. Only with the right information can statutory services link up and ensure that the right care and support is provided to children and young people affected by their parents' offending behaviour. And I move Amendment 39 in my name.
Thank you very much, Mary. Anyone else wish to come in? Cabinet Secretary.
Convener, children can be seriously affected by parental arrest, custody and imprisonment. While there are already areas of good practice, I agree that we need to ensure a consistent multi-agency approach to addressing the impact on children when a parent is arrested or held in custody. This requires strong links between the justice system, statutory services and voluntary organisations working with children and families affected by imprisonment. I've taken on board what Mary Fee has said regarding the interests and well-being of children during initial arrest. Mary Fee has also met with the Minister for Children and Young People on this matter, and I hope that has gone some way to reassuring her of our commitment to work with her to ensure the intent behind these amendments is given effect. I can reassure her that the Scottish Government will be taking steps to address these concerns through implementation of the legislation and through guidance and practice material under the Children and Young People's Scotland Act 2014 to the police and other relevant agencies to ensure that the interests of children are properly protected. And my officials are already engaged with stakeholders to ensure that this happens. I support and commend the intention behind this set of amendments, but I believe that there are more effective ways to achieve the desired outcome of keeping children safe. As drafted, the amendments would alter the careful balanced decision-making process for arresting, holding and charging adult suspects. The bill is designed to deliver a balance between the rights of suspects and the powers of the police in order to serve the interests of justice. This was what was envisaged in the independent Calloway review. Police will be alert to the interests of the child in the carrying out of their duties under the bill. The police would never act in a way which would leave a child open to danger. While the members' amendments pursue the aims of protecting children affected by parental arrest and custody, that aim can be better achieved through the implementation of the Children and Young People's Scotland Act 2014. Amendment 39 would add to the test already contained within Section 10 of the Bill regarding custody decisions. This is a key test under the bill. It is used at various stages to decide whether a suspect can be kept in custody. It balances the needs of the police to manage a criminal investigation and the rights of the suspect, taking into consideration the needs of the inquiry and public safety. This amendment, together with Amendment 42, would require the police to treat suspects with responsibility for children differently. In such cases, the effect on the child of keeping the person in custody would have to be a primary concern in making the custody decision. We all know that children are affected by their parents being arrested, but making that a primary concern when deciding to take someone into custody or keeping them in custody would be out of balance with the already finely balanced test contained within Section 10. The interests of justice and public safety must remain primary considerations when making decisions about whether it is in the interest and proportionate to deprive a person of their liberty. Making custody decisions on that basis does not prevent the police from working to ensure that the immediate care and support needs of affected children will also be met, and that is part of their daily business. The police maintain a duty of care over the arrested person, and that duty naturally extends to any dependent children who have been left exposed by that arrest. It must be remembered that part of their core role is to keep all people safe. If the police become aware of a child's any child's well-being concerns, they would take immediate steps to ensure the safety of the child, be it tracing another parent or relative, engaging social work, bringing the child into a safe environment. This is often done through a close working relationship with partners within social work. I believe that a case-specific approach is both preferable and more practical than the catch-all approach suggested in this particular amendment. Amendment 110 seeks to ensure that when a person is arrested and they have parental responsibilities for a child, that the police contact the child's named person as identified in Part 4 of the Child and Young People's Act. It would never be the case that the police would, when made aware of a well-being concern, would leave a child to fend for themselves without taking action to ensure their welfare needs are addressed. Under the Children and Young People Act, the police will have a duty to share relevant information relating to a child's well-being with the named person's service when appropriate. Amendment 41 to 45 would add to the test already contained within Section 42 for child suspects. The current test within the section requires the police to take account of the well-being of the child before arresting, holding or charging them. The test is there to ensure that, whatever the circumstances, children are arrested, held or charged appropriately and proportionately. This amendment would extend this test to cover all people who have responsibility for a child. In effect, before the police decide to arrest someone, hold them in custody, question or charge them, they would have to consider the well-being of any children they may have responsibility for. This would be out of step with the test already contained within the bill, which are intended to provide a balance between the public interest in investigating crime and protecting public safety and the rights of suspects. Under Amendment 260, which substitutes 46, the scope of the definition of responsibility for a child is very wide. It will cover many people who have legal responsibilities towards children but are not responsible for their care and support on a day-to-day basis. It's important to acknowledge that the police already take steps to identify any childcare issues of persons arrested and take necessary steps to ensure the well-being of children cared for in a partnership with social work colleagues. Police also play a significant role in their localities in protecting children. This amendment, as drafted, could make the assessment police currently undertake more about well-being than well-being and child protection, as is done currently. We do not want to lower or lose current practice already carried out by the police. And my colleague, Aileen Campbell, would also be happy to meet with Mary Fee again ahead of Stage 3 to update her on progress on the development of practice material for children affected by parental detention and how this can be better address their needs, and therefore ask the member not to press her amendment.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Mary, for you to wind up, please.
Thank you, Convener, and I will be very brief. I'm conscious of the time. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his comments and mostly his supportive comments. The Cabinet Secretary is right. I have met the Children's Minister, and I'm glad to hear that he acknowledges the fact that there is more work that we can do on these matters, because I am really keen that we find a way to support this really vulnerable group of children and young people. And given the comments that the Cabinet Secretary has made and his commitment to work both with me and other stakeholders, I'm happy not to at this moment move my amendments.
No, you've moved it, so do you wish to withdraw it?
I wish to withdraw it, sorry.
So maybe if he wishes to withdraw, is that acceptable?
Yes.
Thank you very much. The question is that Section 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I call Amendment 131, the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 131 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? I'm just going to press on committee just for a little bit so we can get just to advisers so that we get to the end of Section 13, because most of the amendments have already been debated. Call Amendment 132 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 116. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 132 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. Call Amendment 133 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 116. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 133 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. Call Amendment 14 in the name of John Pentland. Already debated with Amendment 122. Elaine Murray, move or not move?
Not move.
Call Amendment 134 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with Amendment 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 134 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. Those abstaining. That's 5 in favour, none against, 2 abstentions. That amendment is agreed to.
7.
I beg your pardon. I'm trying to get in 2 facts. 7 for, none against, and 2 abstentions. That amendment is agreed to. The question is that Section 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 15 in the name of John Pentland. Already debated with Amendment 122. Elaine Murray, move or not move?
No move.
Call Amendment 16 in the name of John Pentland. Already debated with Amendment 122. Moved or not moved, Elaine?
Not moved.
The question is that Section 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. Call Amendment 135 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 135 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Mm-hmm. We're not agreed. There'll be a division. Those in favour, please show. Those against, please show. Abstentions? See if I can get it right this time. 7-4, none against, and 2 abstentions. That amendment is agreed to. Call Amendment 136 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 136 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 137 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary. Already debated with 122. Cabinet Secretary to move formally.
Moved.
Question is Amendment 137 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Call Amendment 17 in the name of John Pentland. Already debated with Amendment 122. Elaine Murray, move or not move?
Not move.
Call Amendments 138, 139, 140 and 141, all in the name of the Cabinet Secretary and all previously debated. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move the Amendments 138 to 141 en bloc.
Moved.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 138 to 141? I'm looking at you anxiously, Alison. Well, we don't. The question is Amendments 138 to 141 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
The question is that Section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Now, that concludes the amendment process for today, but we return to them next week, Cabinet Secretary, when I hope you've got the stamina, because I think it's going to be an even longer session. I'm suspending for a couple of minutes. Thank you, Mary. Stay put. Thank you very much. I'm moving now, if everybody will come to attention, item three, public petitions. We have seven ongoing petitions, but we considered two last week relating to fatal accident inquiries on the McGrahy conviction. Paper one provides some background and options for action on the remaining five petitions. I'll go through each in turn. P1501 and PE1567 on investigating unascertained deaths, suicides and fatal accident. That requests that an inquiry be held where a death is determined to be self-inflicted or accidental following suspicious death investigations. PE1567 is looking for a change in the law and procedures in investigations of unascertained deaths, suicide and fatal accidents. We're taking these petitions together because they appear to be making similar requests. In both cases, the petitions come from family members of a person who has died suddenly, who are not satisfied the way the death was investigated. Since the papers were issued, both petitioners have submitted a small amount of additional material which you've had circulated. The Scottish Government has said it's not minded to introduce a form of inquiry similar to a coroner's inquest, which would take place at an earlier stage in the investigation of a death than an FAI. You'll see that petition 1501 petitions have been petitioners have informed us they are not seeking a replica of the coroner's system, but a right to a judicial inquiry at the pre-FAI stage. Members will remember that the Crown Office and PF Service intend to introduce a milestone charter setting out timescales for investigations and decisions in relation to death being investigated by the Crown Office and Prosecution Service. Can I have your views on these petitions? You've got possible options set out on pages four of your paper. Paper one, what are your views? It's awfully quiet. I'm waiting for the tumbleweed to blow past after. You're just exhausted. Yes, Roddy.
Yeah. I don't have a problem in seeking further information from the Crown Office on how they evaluate suspicious investigations.
Any other comments? John?
Yes. No, I would support Roddy on that. I don't think it's helpful to say there is recourse, it's judicial review. I don't think that's helpful, as one of the communications says. That's not something that families would ordinarily resort to. And so I think we need to take the opportunity there, as Roddy says, to get further information.
And, of course, we now have the undertaking that's been given by the Solicitor General that if there's not an FAI, the family or members don't have to request. They will now be told why there's not going to be an FAI. Yes. Does anybody else want to? Alison?
Well, I would support pursuing this a bit further because at the heart of this is the need for families to be able to challenge the police findings, particularly in relation to PE 1501, where there was an assumption that it was a self-inflicted death.
Yeah. So, what do you wish us to seek from the Crown Office and Prosecution Service?
Yes.
How they evaluate
yes.
the option three?
Option three, I think.
Right, and seek further. Thank you very much. P1479 in legal profession and the legal aid time bar. Petitioner is asking the time bar for making complaints against legal profession be removed completely. The Scottish Legal Complaints Commission plans to increase the time bar from 1 to 3 years, although there appears to have been a delay in implementing this change. The clerks have sought to find out from the SLCC why there's been this delay and when the changes will now come into effect, but no answer has yet been provided. When did you seek this information? How long the delays have been? So it's 2 or 3 weeks they've had to reply, so it's not just yesterday. So can I have your views on this petition, please?
Until we get a reply, otherwise it might just never be heard of again. So.
Can you also perhaps advise me, I'm trying to recall, there's always a discretion in any event, even if it were 3 years, there might be a discretion where somebody, I take it there is a discretion, somebody might not know they've anything to complain about. But that's covered. There's already that. That's fine. So we'll chase this up in a stronger worded, more strongly worded letter. I'm good at those now. I'm getting good at strongly worded letters.
There's been no convener's letter. It's been at official level.
Oh, it's official level. Well, I'll put my voice to it now. That's sure to make the wheels turn. We hope. PE 1510, enclosure of police, fire and non-emergency centres north of Dundee. The clerk's paper discusses this petition along with petition PE 1511. Since the committee last considered the petition, the Cabinet Secretary announced that the police control rooms north of Dundee will not be closed until the new control rooms have the staff systems and processes to take the additional demand. P1511 and closure of the fire and rescue control in Inverness. Since that was done, these were raised during our last evidence session with the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, Fire Inspector and Fire Brigade Union, 20th April. Can I have your views on both of these petitions and possible options are set out in pages 6 and 7 of paper 1? Alison, then John, please.
Thank you. I think things have changed since these were lodged, given the interim review that we had into police call centre control rooms. I'm particularly concerned that we establish whether or not the fire service has taken proper cognizance of that particular report, although it related to police, because the issues round about staff retention, vacancies and call handling, I think, are pertinent to the fire service, and we haven't asked them whether or not they've taken that up. So could we write to the fire service and take that up, please?
You agreed? John?
Yeah, I certainly support that, convener. I also support keeping it open until the full report has been received and been considered. I think that may be some time off here.
Yes, and take it that we're keeping both open. We're keeping the other one open until there's a report, and this one we're writing in any event. Thank you very much. I move on to item 4, subordinate legislation. It's consideration of two instruments not subject to any parliamentary procedure. These are the Act of Sederent Rules of the Court of Session 1994 and Sheriff Court Rules Amendment No. 3, Miscellaneous 2015, SSI 2015/283, and the Act of Sederent Rules of the Court of Session 1994 and Ordinary Cause Rules 1993 Amendment Child Welfare Reporters, SSI 2015/312. Both instruments have been drawn to Parliament's attention by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. The first has been drawn to our attention because it has a minor drafting error, and the second, the meaning of the two articles could be clearer. Now, these are not, I think these are a matter for the Lord President's office in the drafting and not the legislation team here, there or anywhere, whether it's the government or whether it's the Parliament. The Lord President's private office has undertaken to correct the errors when the rules are next amended. Are members content to endorse the DPLR's comments on these instruments? Thank you very much. That concludes today's meeting, as we have already decided to raise budget scrutiny and work programme at another meeting. Right, that concludes this meeting. Thank you.